Hello, everyone. Thank you for joining today's webinar. My name is Alberta Noonan, and I'm from the New England QIO, and I'll be your moderator for today's webinar. The webinar's name is Using the New COP-QAPI to Reduce Readmissions. Before we get started, I want to review a few housekeeping items. Just hold on 1 second, please. I have to clear the lines. 1 moment, please.
The leader has muted your line. To unmute your line, press #6.
Thank you for your patience. As I was saying, before we get started, I want to review a few housekeeping items. This call will be recorded for training purposes. I'll provide you with details on accessing the recording at the end of the webinar. The phone lines will be on mute for the duration of the presentation. We will take questions at the end of the presentation. At that time, I will provide you with instructions on how you can ask a question over the phone. You can also post the question in the chat box throughout the presentation. Please make sure to send the question to all participants. Today's presenter is Kathy Roby from the Connecticut office of the New England Quinn QIO, and assisting her is Charlotte Dagenger, who's also from the Connecticut office. And at this time, I'm going to pass this over to Kathy.
Good afternoon, everyone. I'm happy to have you with us. We are going to be talking today about how you can use the new Conditions of Participation QAPI process so that you can reduce your workload and accomplish multiple things with one QAPI process. Our goal today is that at the conclusion of this program, you will have a clear, better understanding of the new QAPI process from the COPs, with the wording right from CMS themselves, and understanding how you can use that. You'll be able to gather the data that you need. You'll be able to identify a target goal that is clearly based on that data, then create and implement a plan to achieve that goal, and then evaluate your progress steps. You'll understand how to use this new process step by step to create or revise a performance improvement project whose ultimate mission is to reduce readmissions, prevent avoidable use of the emergency room, and last but certainly not least, you can celebrate the fact that you've achieved compliance with the new QAPI process with your newly created Readmission Prevention Performance Improvement Project. We can all remember the way we were. Life was so much simpler, wasn't it, when the process was a simple list of 4 very structured tasks. Every quarter, you selected a quote-unquote random group of files that reflected all of the different disciplines whose services you had provided to your clients. You used a form, usually of your own creation, and you reviewed those files, presumably for both quality and compliance. You documented and reviewed your adverse events. What were you actually doing with those reports? Tracking how many falls, were they observed or not observed, what kind of infections, and did they have them when they came to you, or did they acquire them while they were with you? You educated and evaluated your clinical staff. You documented those record reviews and documented all your competencies and your adverse events in those lovely, long, boring quarterly and annual reports. But ask yourself, the way we were, did we really use this information for anything other than a fat notebook, or a skinny one, that sat on your shelf and got really dusty until the surveyors rolled in. The focus of the way we were was to make sure we complied with all those regulations, remediate compliance deficiencies, and address any staff needs with education programs. We certainly did conduct some performance improvement projects. We used those to improve processor outcomes that were glaringly deficient in the CASPER system. But ask yourself, honestly, not out loud, so you don't have to fess up, did it really affect or change the way we cared for patients in any appreciable way? Did we make significant change or improvement? Because if we didn't, there's a new sheriff in town. On January 13th, they said, here's the new rules. But because we're nice, we're going to give you 6 months to figure out, look at all your data, and identify a patient-centered, data-driven new approach to working with quality improvement process. In the Federal Register, they have identified for us that our new COPs are entirely focused around, and this is a quote, a patient-centered, interdisciplinary approach to meeting patients' needs. And in terms of quality management, the statement in the Federal Register says, quality improvements must incorporate an outcome-oriented, data-driven quality assessment and performance improvement program specific to each home health agency. So we are no longer looking at doing generic quarterly clinical record reviews, tracking how many of what kind of falls or infections we had, and how many in services of what nature did you provide your staff. Now, this needs to be data-driven and specific to your home health agency, your data, and what you do. Let's take a look at a little more detail on what the COP is actually directing us to do. I would point you to 484.65, where it says the home health agency must measure, analyze, and track quality indicators, including adverse patient events, and other aspects of performance that enable the agency to assess process of care, services, and operations. You must focus on high-risk, high-volume, or problem-prone areas. You must consider the incidence, prevalence, and severity of the problems in those areas. And you must have a plan that leads to the immediate correction of any problem that directly or potentially threatens the health and safety of patients. So why am I saying that this new process has in its inherent nature to keep patients out of the hospital? Because under the comprehensive assessment section of the new COPs, it is very clear that we must do a risk assessment from the clinician's perspective and the patient's perspective of how and why they actually went to the hospital the most recent time and what they think or the nurse thinks might trigger a readmission. And having identified that, combining that with the overall quality plan will enable them to have avoidance plans that are both patient-specific and on an agency-wide level can reduce the risk for many patients. So what is the new way of looking at this? Remember the regulation says, effective, ongoing, agency-wide, data-driven. And it must also be patient-centered. Patient-centered at the individual patient level and at the global agency-wide patient level. It must involve every service, program, and discipline that you offer. If you have an infusion program, a specialty program such as CHF control and patient self-management, a pediatric program, whatever you offer, your quality program must look at all of the data, all of the potential and present issues that you might have. Look at what the indicators are that could possibly lead to improving your outcomes. Specifically, in this case, reducing the use of emergent care, reducing hospital initial and readmissions. How can you show improvement in these indicators so that you are getting better outcomes, maximizing patient safety, those falls will get you every time, and improving the quality of care overall? We need to identify what those quality indicators might be, measure them, analyze those measurements, and then track them over time. This includes adverse events, and we're going to look at them in more than just numbers of observed, unobserved, and how many and what kind. We need to know more about them. We need to know what the indicators are. What are the risk factors? What are the things we could have, should have, would have done so that they wouldn't have happened? We need to identify our processes of care, the services we offer, and the manner or the operations in which we offer them. Again, in the regulation, it specifically says your QAPI program must be unique and specific to your agency based on your performance data. Your performance improvement initiatives are created on that data. And your overall program plan needs to include the initiatives that will address improving specific identified outcomes, reducing the use of emergency rooms, reducing and preventing hospital admissions and readmissions. Keep patients safe by decreasing falls and decreasing infections. Once you've looked at the data, created the program, identified the performance improvement initiatives, you now must have this program approved in advance by your governing body. They need, in their documented minutes, to have reviewed your proposed program, approved it, and indicated their support. We all know that doing these performance improvement programs, these PICs, require money. They require time, and time from your staff is expensive. You may need new documents. You may need new tools, new booklets, new signs, new magnets, all kinds of things. The support of your governing body needs to be up front, not just as a vote to approve, but supported by financial and active intervention from their members. Your program, once approved, needs to be monitored in an ongoing way using that data to continue to track whether the plans you put in place are actually working. If they're not as effective as you want them to be, you need to refocus and continue to collect data so that you can ultimately achieve the improvements that are set out in your plan. So, how can you go about implementing the new QAPI COP and still be an active participant in the QIO project? There is so much to do in your agency. You're getting referrals every day. You get caught up in the day-to-day. There is so little time. You need to see patients. You need to get the work done, get the orders out, track the orders, know where your patients are. Did they get all the right forms signed? So much to do, so little time. How do you make this work so that you can have an effective, data-driven, specific to you quality plan and at least three PIPs, performance improvement projects, and still be part of the QIO project? How do you do that? You do that by combining the two initiatives. By putting together a QAPI plan that includes the elements that you've been asked to look at as a part of the QIO program. We're focusing on cardiovascular improvement, improving blood pressure control, monitoring a patient's education and understanding of their anticoagulants, their aspirin use, decreasing smoking. If those are the QIN QIO initiatives and you're trying to incorporate those into your already busy lives and getting them into your QAPI program, how do you do that? You do that by starting at the beginning with your data. What kind of data do you need to get this done? We're going to look at a list, and then we're going to talk about each of these items in terms of what they can tell you, how often you need to run them, and how you're going to actually use them. The different types of data you need are the CASPER reports. You're going to want the most recent ones available, and we'll talk about what they tell you and why you want them. HCAHPS, your patient satisfaction survey. You should always have right at hand the last two quarters and your rolling 12-month trend. Home health compare data. It's going to tell you how your agency stood compared or against the state and regional or national data. PEPPER data, again, this is provided to you by CMS, and we just recently had a reminder that the newest PEPPER data is now out. You need to download this. You need to have it available. You need to understand what it is that it can tell you. I didn't forget them. The scrubber reports are critical. If your agency does not yet have one of the data scrubbers attached to your electronic medical record, I am telling you today, it is not my place to tell you which one to get, but I'm telling you, you need one. Look at the different programs available, have demonstrations, figure out what your budget can afford. Remember, we said your governing authority needed to provide material support, and this is one way they can do that, by approving the expense of getting a good scrubber program attached to your EMR. And with that scrubber, you're going to run what we like to call the infamous top 10 lists. And we'll talk about what exactly those lists are and why you need them. So what are you going to print from CASPER? Are you going onto the CASPER website on a regular basis? I mean regular, like every month? Do you know how to put these reports together? How to run them, and to look at what they're telling you. We strongly urge you to run these four reports. Your agency case mix, the patient-related characteristics, gives you critically important data about your caseload. It tells you, on average, about the risk adjustment factors, how old your patients are. Are they predominantly male or female? What are their functional limitations? What are their living situations? Is there caregivers in the majority of your patients or not? What are the most common diagnoses you're seeing? You need this information, and I would urge you to run it. I prefer every quarter, but at the very least, every 6 months. Process outcome measures come in a variety of formats, but you truly want the 3-bar. It's going to tell you your past performance, your most recent performance, and how you compare to the national. You also need the potentially avoidable adverse events. There's a 3-bar and a specific patient listing. Process outcome I would run at least quarterly because you need time to show the impact of the work you're doing. But the avoidable events, these adverse events, 3-bar and patient listing, I recommend that you run these. At least the patient listing should be run monthly, and I'll tell you why in a second. And the 3-bar would be done every quarter with the process outcome measures. Because, again, it does take time for the impact of your efforts to show. The patient listing, however, this you run monthly because and to transmit OASIS data. As new events occur, the patients involved in those events will appear. And it's not so much the total list after the first couple of times you run this that you're looking at. You're looking at who are the new names that just appeared on this list. Because these are the patients whose records you need to pull. You need to audit those files and find out, could I have avoided that adverse event? Was there something that the primary nurse, primary therapist, the case manager, the clinical manager could have, should have done to avoid that event from happening? So these are the things that this these reports can tell us. And they're going to inform our new QAPI plan because they tell us what is the population I'm dealing with and working with, what are the outcomes that are the most egregious that I really need to work on, and what are the adverse events that are causing me the most difficulty. Do they relate? How do they link to the outcomes? Do I have an unusual number of infections? Does that tie to my diagnoses on admission? If you have a high number of infections that are required and a high number of referrals and readmissions to the hospital for sepsis or for UTI or URI, you can see clearly there's a link there, and you want to make sure that your PIP is addressing that link. Remember I said I would talk to you about my famous top 10 reports, the Sclubber reports? The big difference between CASPER and the Sclubber reports is all about the timing. CASPER reports are data that tells you where you were 6 months ago. Sclubber reports tell you today is the 18th of July, and the Sclubber reports are going to tell you where you were on the 30th of June. And that is very important information. So what reports should you be running from that Sclubber? You need to know what are the top 10 most frequent HHRGs and or diagnoses on admission, primary and first secondary, that you're getting. What are the top 10 least frequent ones? You're going to look at, for each of those groups, the top 10 most and least frequent, you're going to look at what were the visits by discipline that I provided in those episodes of care. The number of visits per episode, the national average, is available to you. You need to take that information. Now compare that to the visits by discipline for each of your HERG group data. Once you have looked at those, you're going to be, I think, surprised. How closely are you to the number of visits, nursing visits per episode, the number of therapy visits? Are your home health aid visits too high? Are your therapy visits too low? Are you not providing OT, but rather providing the home health aid? Do you remember provide an aid, provide an OT, because we need to teach them how to bathe again, not to do it for them? Every month, and then quarterly again, you're going to run the Sclubber version of the CASPER reports. You can get them out of the Sclubber. You can get a thumbnail sketch of the characteristics of your patient population. You can look at, by running your discharge OASIS reports, you can look at the reasons for discharge, the top 10 most frequent readmission causes. We can look at the adverse events. We can look at falls and infections on admission, during the course of care, and at discharge. This is going to give you very important current information that when stood side by side against your CASPER data 6 months ago and now, you can see the trending. You can see, are we getting better, getting worse, holding our own? Are the causes shifting, which might mean you'd have to shift one of your PIP programs? So that's why these Sclubber reports are so critically important. We're going to talk also a little bit about that readmission causes, the OASIS transfer discharge RFA, because there are some changes coming that will affect that. But for now, let's move on to two other types of reports. Home health compare. As I said, this is going to give you comparison information. It's going to line your agency up. You can line yourself up against your peers in your immediate competitive area, against your state, and you have the CASPER for the national. What is the importance of patient satisfaction? When we first began to deal with HCAHPS reports, I can't tell you how many times agency staff would say, you know, this is patient satisfaction. You can't please all of the people all of the time. Somebody's always going to be unhappy that I didn't get out there fast enough. I didn't return their call fast enough. I wasn't nice enough. They didn't like the color of my uniform. Whatever. I can't make them all happy. What we need to understand about the HCAHPS is that this survey groups the queries to provide you five blended scores. So when you're looking at those scores, you need to then back down, break them down into the individual queries that came together to provide those five scores. By taking them as a group of questions, you can now look at those questions and match those to outcomes with lower scores in the CASPER or SCRUBBER reports that you've run. Let me give you an example. If you were to look at all of the group of questions that center around medications, in the HCAHPS survey questions, there are times when we ask our patients to tell us, did your nurse or therapist seem knowledgeable about your medications? Did they reconcile your medications? Did they contact your physician about your medications? Did they teach you about your medications? First of all, what patient or caregiver is going to understand what medication reconciliation means? You need to do some homework preparing your patients for these surveys so that they understand when they receive them what the questions are they're being asked. That really means, did the nurse sit down, go over all the medications with you and make sure that you were taking the right medications at the right dose at the right time in the right way? By looking at those, if the patient satisfaction or the answers indicate that from the patient's perspective, you weren't very knowledgeable or you didn't seem to be, they don't remember you teaching them about the medications. They don't remember you helping to clarify dosages or calling the physician for a change. If they don't remember those things, do you think there could be a causative link there with the patient who has an exacerbation of CHF because they're not taking their medications properly, they didn't understand the importance of weighing themselves and then taking that extra diuretic? That's how you draw the link between your outcome scores, your CASPER process outcome, your home health compare, and your HCAHPS. That's the line that you need to draw to connect all of these dots, so that then you will be able to understand what the data is telling you and be able to clearly target and narrow the scope of the performance improvement projects you want to create. We were given a grace from January 13th through July 1st of this year. Our goal for that time period was to collect and review the data that was available to us, to understand and assess our process, our services, and how we were providing those services. We needed to understand what the data was telling us. We needed to understand how that data reflects the quality of the care we provide and pick out where the most critical opportunities for improvement are. If you're looking at outcome measures that say that your patients are not improving in shortness of breath by the end of the episode, they are not improving in their ability to reliably understand and take their medication correctly. And one of the highest readmission causes is CHF exacerbation, exacerbation of cardiac disease, respiratory distress. This is telling you something, especially when the HCAHPS data chimes right in and says, patients don't think that you're reconciling the meds, that you're not teaching them, and they don't understand them anyway. So now you've just completed a root cause analysis. You've connected those dots. You've identified what factors go together. You've set a clinical standard, and now you're going to identify a series of actions to comprise a performance improvement plan that will address the target of the root cause you just identified and create a plan to improve it. So we've had to look at what's the relationship between different causes of readmissions and specific processor outcome measures. Is there a common diagnosis that matches with these as well? And HCAHPS queries that we can link together. We have looked at an example. We've looked at a linkage that could be there between causes of readmission, such as CHF, shortness of breath, and so on, with your patients not improving in controlling their shortness of breath, not improving in their medication compliance and control. That the common diagnosis might be CHF, another cardiac diagnosis, or a respiratory one. Is there even more detailed information that you can get at, that you can use, so you can really create an effective action plan? A deeper dive can give you the answers that you might need. There is a reporting process called Tally. If you are proficient in using the CASPER system, if you have someone in your office who is proficient with CASPER or with Excel, you can create Tally reports that will tell you very specific patient-level information about which patients did not achieve which outcomes in the CASPER data, which, as we know, is 6 months old. It's from 6 months ago. But that historical data is critical. So if you look at what is the outcome you're going to study, I need to know, I decided from the level of data analysis I've done, I have a problem with CHF, I have a problem with patients not improving in their respiratory status and going to the hospital with respiratory distress and exacerbation of CHF. I need to look at what patients did not achieve the specific outcome of improving in their respiratory status. So if you run the Tally report for that outcome, it will give you a patient-specific list of who didn't achieve those outcomes 6 months ago. Your scrubber will give you the same information for as of June 30th, 2018. If you take that information plus the information, a patient-specific list of who was transferred to the hospital, to the emergency room, with respiratory distress, with a medication noncompliance issue, and match that to the list of names on the Tally report for who did not achieve the outcome and the list of names for who went to the hospital with which diagnosis, now you have a common trend. So if you take that plus your adverse event patient listing and your scrubber equivalent, now you have a much more manageable pile of charts to review. Take those charts, audit them. What are we asking ourselves in that audit? Were these readmissions, were these outcomes avoidable or inevitable? I can live with the patient with advanced osteoporosis who loses their balance and falls and breaks a hip. It's inevitable. It was going to happen sooner or later. What's not inevitable is not being effective in teaching medication management, patient self-management, and CHF, so that your patient clearly understands how to take their medication, why they need to weigh themselves, how to take FPRN Lasix, and so on and so on. I see those as in many times at least partially avoidable. So you want to do these chart audits, identify what is avoidable, what are the trends, and that will enable you to really define a very carefully crafted performance improvement project to target the problem areas and trends. Okay, we looked at all that data, we did a deep dive, we found the trends and the problems. Now what? How do you take that and create patient-centered, data-driven, agency-specific plans? Well, it's your data, right? It's patient-centered. You went right down to the patient level, looking at charts and identifying specific patients. It's data-driven. You've looked at it and identified the trends, and it's yours. It's not somebody else's. Let's take an example and play with it a little bit so that we can make a sample and give you a better feel for what you might be doing. Your data analysis, for example, will say it showed you that the three leading causes of readmissions in your agency were UTIs and/or urosepsis, CHF exacerbations, and wound infections. And by studying those charts, you determined that 75% of the patients who sought emergency room care and/or were readmitted to the hospital did not call your agency first to identify their symptoms, talk to a clinician, and gain appropriate intervention. Chart audits of these files at the patient level indicated poor compliance with medications, poor compliance with self-management and identification of disease exacerbation, and poor compliance with hand hygiene, which in turn leads to infections. So your plan is going to be comprised of four separate components, four performance improvement initiatives. Your first is an overall agency-wide performance goal of reducing your readmissions by 5% and reducing your call the nurse first. The fact that 75% of your readmissions did not, you want to reduce that number down to at least 50%, if not 25%. Those three causes of readmissions, you're looking to reduce each of them, the UTI or urosepsis, CHF or wound infection, by 5% each. So, to do this. Hello, somebody here is not muted. Would you please check and make sure that your phone is muted? Thank you, Alberta. Or press star 6. Each of these causes that we've identified, each of these projects will have its own 90 to 120 day long performance improvement project. So we talked about the governing authority and their role in this. A formal document that outlines what your overall goal for the year is and what your individual performance improvement projects are and what their goals will be. As we said in the beginning, your governing authority has to review this plan, document its approval, and allocate resources to the process. This is how they document their support. The plan that you present to the GA must include a summary statement of the goal, each of the performance projects, with the data supporting each one of those selections. So you present the data, present how you did your analysis, and why you've selected these performance improvement projects, and then what your goals are for each one of them. So you're going to increase agency contact prior to calling 911 by at least 25%. decrease the incidence of UTI urosepsis by 5%, decrease CHF readmissions or accessing emergent care by 5%, decrease URI pneumonia by 5%. So how am I doing that exactly? Because those of us in home health, we tend to be very practical people. We don't have the time for a lot of theorizing. If there's going to be a performance improvement project, it needs to be concrete and relatively easy to implement. So if your hospitalization rate were, for example, God forbid, 30.2%, as of your most recent Casper and reinforced by what your scrubber is telling you, you need to decrease the number of episodes of care ending in a hospitalization to 27.2% as of whatever date you choose, but I would recommend a date that is at least 6 months out, remembering that the Casper data is always 6 months old. You'll have interim reports for yourself if you use your scrubber to look at how things are improving. You also want to access the Home Health Quality Improvement, HHQI, their ACH report. And as a member of the Home Health Cardio RAN, you have access to this data. So you need to be accessing this website and looking at this report, because it's going to tell you not only where you are right now, it's going to tell you as you move forward how you are or are not improving. And if you look at the detail level of the HHQI ACH report, it's going to tell you some very interesting things. It's going to tell you, for instance, those months of the year and those days of the week which are the most prone to patients going to the hospital. It will give you very interesting information, and then you can really target your project plans. So if we're trying to reduce readmissions, and one of the ways we're tackling that is to improve call the nurse first by 25%, what are we going to do? What are some of the interventions that we're going to do in order to make this work? We're going to download from HHQI, we're going to download that Call Me First poster. And once we have it, we're going to distribute it to every patient that we have on service at this moment. We're going to review that with them. We're going to make sure that they really know what it is and how to use it. We're going to make sure that our on-call staff are fully aware of what they should be doing and how they should be responding when patients call. If you have concerns about how your staff are responding to these calls, then I would encourage you to go back to the HHQI website, back to the best practice packages, and look for the triage tools that they do have that will help your on-call staff. They need to understand that if a visit needs to be made to prevent a readmission or an ER trip, then they need to make that visit. Stoplight tools are also available on the HHQI website if you're not already using them. These are really perfect for training patients of all levels, all educational and language levels, in how to identify when they need to call the agency first and when they really should call 911 first and then have a family member call you while they're waiting. Remember, part of the conditions of participation says you are required to do a clinician and a patient assessment of the hospitalization risk. That has to be part of the admission and initial care planning process. So if you do that assessment and you do it with the patient caregiver, this is now an integral part of their plan of care, and it's making it possible for your clinicians to to create a plan with the patient using the Spotlight tool so that now the patient understands, oh, I have a fever of 100.5. On the Spotlight tool, it says I should call my nurse, not be call 911. Oh, my dressing fell off. I should call the nurse. But she taught me how to slap something on it until she can get here. This is how you avoid the emergency room visits and the readmissions. By working with the patient to help them identify what the risks are of them going back. What are the things most likely to send them back? And then creating and customizing the Spotlight tools to those identified risks so that then you can tailor your teaching, tailor your education, emphasize, call me first. You're in the green or the yellow zone, call me first. If it's truly in the red zone, call 911, but make sure somebody else in your family picks up their cell phone and calls the agency because we need to prepare the emergency room for your arrival. And also make sure you get your patients back. Using the PDSA process will ensure the success of your project. In the planning phase, what is it that you need to do? Obtain or create all your needed materials. The materials that I've been referencing, call me first posters, magnets, what have you, the masters are on the HHQI website. The Spotlight tools on the HHQI website in the BPIP section. Look for the BPIP on ACH reduction. They're in there. The teletriage tools are in there. Gather those materials. Customize them for your agency, for your specific patients. Remember, this has to be your plan specific to the patients you have. That means if you have 30% of patients that speak Spanish, 28% that speak Russian or Polish, you need to have those materials language specific. You need to educate your staff in how they're going to implement this process. Educate them in how to do a patient self-assessment for hospitalization risk. This is one of the, as much as it sounds like you're going to be pulling teeth to get the information, trust me, if you ask the question the right way, your patients and their families are dying to tell you what happened when they went to the hospital the last time. It's their story. Let them tell you. Because until you've been the one who woke up at 2 in the morning, so short of breath you can't breathe, and you're so scared you're going to die in the dark alone, they want to tell you about that. And that's your open door to get them to work with you to make sure it doesn't happen again. So teach them. Let them practice how to do a self-assessment, how to do their assessment, how to teach call the nurse first, and the Spotlight tools, so that your patients will feel secure, protected, and know they always have a nurse available to them. So what are you going to do? Select a champion clinician in each team. Let them help you to teach their peers. Set goals. We're going to give the call the nurse first in this whole package to every new admission, and we're going to go back and get at least 2 or 3 of our open cases every single week until we've got everybody. Initiate your project agency-wide. Reinforce how important this is. And over time, reward positive staff participation. Remember I said you're going to go back and run your CASPER, some of it quarterly, some of it monthly, and your scrubber. You're going to run those regularly because that's going to track your progress on a monthly basis. You're going to audit charts. Make some home visits. Are the posters in? Are they up? Is education charted? What about the on-call logs? What's the response time in the activity? Audit every readmission for cause. Was the poster in use? Was a personal, patient-specific emergency response plan in place? Study your report data from your internal scrubber, from your internal record audits, so that you know where you're progressing and where you're not. And then you're going to act on that information. Revise, re-educate, reinforce, restructure based on new data each month. Every time you revise and restructure a little, you're going to get better data and get better improvement. Find a way to maintain those gains as you get ready to move on to the next project. Your recipe for success is to set an overall goal. I'm going to improve or increase patient contact before 911 by 25%. I'm going to reduce my UTI urosepsis by 5. I'm going to select performance projects that are related to one another. Build them with PDSA. And if they are cardiovascular related, you have now found that you are fully compliant with a 2018 COP QAPI project, and you're an active participant in the Quinn QIO project. So you can celebrate that success. So we have some time left, and we would like to have some open discussion and answer any questions you might have, and I'm turning it over to Alberta.
Okay, thank you, everyone. At this time, we'll take some questions. If you'd like to ask a question over the phone, please press #6. And you can pose your question in the chat box by sending your message to all participants.
While we're waiting to see if anyone has any questions, I hope that you've been thinking a little bit about what tools you might have and how you would go about implementing training your staff. We found with some of the agencies that we work one-on-one with that they have put together a cheat sheet, a crib sheet, so to speak, of what documents, what processes they are wanting their nurses to use and to collect when they're in the home, so that we're making sure that that risk assessment gets done, making sure that a personal patient intervention for symptom changes, that plan is created and in the home. These are things that need to be done. Charlotte, do you have something you could add?
Yeah, absolutely. And I think one of the big important things about this is when you're looking at those processes is identifying where in the medical record are you going to capture those interventions, where are you going to capture the evidence that the nurses maybe used, you know, stop and wash or call me first or whatever are the tools that you decided to utilize in your QAPI program, and have an agreement of where that is. That way, when it comes time to get into the study component of your PIP, it'll be much easier for you to go back and find that evidence and know where it is.
Very good. Because when we don't have things uniformly located in a chart, your audits won't be as effective, and they'll take you twice as long. It's very important that when within your own agency, everyone is doing things as close to the same way as possible. It does take some time and some practice for your staff to be comfortable with creating these personal patient response plans, with creating a patient-friendly plan of care, with helping your patients to identify, how did I get to this point? One thing you might want to consider when you're doing this is the element of fear and concern, the element of loss of control, and that's a whole other webinar in and of itself, but think about that. When you're 75, 80, 85, 90, think about how they look at the newspaper. They look at the obituaries first. When they've been awakened at 3 in the morning with chest pain or shortness of breath, when they've fallen And like Mrs. Fletcher in the commercial, they can't get up. They're scared. They don't want these things to happen. They don't want to be in the hospital. Truly, they don't. So it's up to us to find a way to help them, let them tell you their story, then guide them to identify how they're going to work with you to make sure it doesn't happen again. So we're almost out of time. I haven't seen any questions. Sometimes people are a little bashful about that. So on your screen, you have my contact information here at Qualidyme, my desk number, and you have contact information for my partner in crime here. And Charlotte and I will be happy to take your emails and your calls so that we can help you one-on-one. If you're more comfortable that way, please feel free to give us a quick email or a phone call. And we're happy to talk to you one-on-one about the particular issues your agency might be dealing with or a really particularly difficult performance project you want to tackle, but you're not quite sure how to go about that. So please feel free. Reach out. We're here. We're happy to talk to you. Okay. Thank you, Kathy. And thanks to all of you for a great discussion. I have a few last-minute announcements before we end today's call. And that is a reminder that we are now on social media. Visit us on Facebook, LinkedIn, and YouTube. And when you close out this webinar, the evaluation will automatically pop up on your computer. If you could please fill that out, we would greatly appreciate it. If you don't have time to fill out the evaluation right now, or if you're currently sharing a computer with someone else, you'll receive an email tomorrow with the link to the evaluation as well as the link to the event page on our website. The slides are available on the webpage, and within the next few business days, the recording and transcript of this webinar will also be added. I put the link in the chat box again for you, and thank you for attending, and have a great day. Goodbye, everyone.